We're glad to have this real good crowd this morning. I think everybody's looking for some answers, and I hope we can give you some today. Like I say, I'd like to welcome you to our Cotton Commission 9th Annual meeting. And I'd like to thank Tifton and the UGA Cotton team. I'd also like to thank and recognize Dr. Laura Johnson and Dr. Joe West. I don't know where there he is. I'd like to appreciate y'all for having us here today. We also like to thank our many sponsors. I hope y'all take time and go out there and talk to these guys, because they really help us a lot with our meeting. And at this time, I'd like to recognize the commission members, and I'd ask them to stand if they will when I call their name. We have our vice president, Mr. Lee Crumbly from Bullock County. Lee. We have Jimmy Ware from Leesburg. Jimmy, where you at? Leesburg. Leary, Georgia. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, we have Stephen Meeks from Wayne County. Stephen, he's in the back. Have Matt Coley down here in the front from Dooley County. Bart Davis from Colquitt. John Ruart from Morgan County. We also have advisory members, which is Mr. Gary Bell, Evans County, Eddie Greens, Dooley County, and Chad Mathis. I think Chad's with us today. Glad to have them. We also have our two ex officios, which is Mr. Gary Black, Commissioner of Agriculture, and Mr. Gerald Long, President of Georgia Farm Bureau. And our office staff, we have Chris Yamone, our Director of Public Affairs. Chris is probably outside somewhere. Also have Martha Harris, she's outside too. And also like to recognize that we got Jody Redding from Senator Isaacson office. Jody, everybody knows Jody. We also have David Rupenecker. David, he's a Georgia Southern, Southern cotton growers, excuse me, Dave. But also with David, we have David Dumelo, and he's from North Carolina, and he drove 9 hours to be here. So we're real proud to have David with us today. And if you get a chance, talk to David, and we're looking for, because he's the president of Georgia Southern cotton growers now. So get a chance, talk to David. And next we have Richie Seaton. He's our executive director, and Richie does us a real good job. He's been with the Cotton Commission a good long time, so if anybody knows Georgia cotton, it's Richie Seaton. So let's give Richie a warm welcome and applause.
Thank you, Mike. I appreciate that. Usually he has a kind word for me and pokes me in the ribs a little bit, but Mike's a great chairman, and the commission, we got a lot of good guys on there, and they work hard for you, and I hope y'all appreciate what they do for you. I'd like to add my greetings to y'all this morning. In addition to Mike's, we appreciate y'all being here. Obviously, we're facing some difficult times with cotton right now, but you've got folks that are working real hard for you, and as I think it says, this too shall pass. First of all, these are our sponsors. Let's all give them a hand. They've been great to work with, and they allow us to have a great meeting. And I'm going to hopefully try to run through some things that the commission's done this year, and hope y'all enjoy the program. And our speakers will certainly be willing to answer your questions. And again, thank y'all for being here. There we go. Our producers pay us $1 a bale. We take that dollar and we spend about 55% of it with the National Cotton Council, about 10% with Southern cotton growers. Excuse me. And research, we're going to spend a bit of time on research today, but about 25% of our budget goes there. We spend somewhere in the neighborhood of $600,000 on different projects supporting our research and extension cotton folks. And we do a small promotional program. Mainly we do that because when I started many years ago, the board reminded me that the assessments come out of the same farmers' pockets, and you're going to hear from Barry Worsham in a little bit, and you'll hear hear a report from the real professional promoters, and we direct our promotions more towards young folks, school kids, and the general public. For the past 2 years, we have done a sponsorship with the Georgia Public Television for high school sports, and that's turned out real good. Our message there is we're always touching on the positive attributes of cotton, but most importantly, we are talk about the economic impact that our crop has on the state. Our research, these are just a few highlights. We, I think, do a very good job of identifying what you guys need, and through the county agents, through our extension cotton team, through the producer leadership on our board, what we try to do is take your dollars and put it into research projects that will help our UGA folks develop and disseminate the information that will will help you be successful and more efficient in your farming operations. A couple of examples: Dr. John Snyder is our cotton physiologist. He's looking at irrigation and water efficiency in a number of ways, even in which varieties are more water efficient. Dr. Philip Roberts been around a long time, and Philip always does everything he can to help you keep your sprayer parked and but also controlling your insects. Glenn Harris looks at fertility. Glenn's going to be doing some different stuff for us this year, and also he does a lot of evaluation of new products. This is something new this year that we came up with. Cotton Leads is a program that the Cotton Council, Cotton Incorporated, the Australian Cotton Growers, and numerous folks are involved in, and Dr. George Valitis and Wes Porter came to us with this project this year, and basically this is going to take the Cotton Leads program and put a Georgia spin on it, so we will be able to see how this program works and how we stack up, and most importantly document the reduction in the environmental footprint of producing cotton. This is important. Y'all might ask why it's important. The simple reason is folks can get up and say anything they want to about our crop. Several years ago, I think I even heard somebody from Walmart said it took 8 or 9 pounds of a pesticide to make a pound of cotton. This is totally outlandish, and we can't make those statements. We've got to back our information has got to be, our information must be good science-based, and this is the best way to combat it. I would urge y'all, when you're sitting around on your computer, is to look up this Cotton Leads, because there's some absolutely outstanding data, and you'll be proud of what agriculture's done to reduce our environmental footprint in a lot of different ways. We also try to make our research easily available for you. Dr. Jared Whitaker coordinates our county variety trials. If you can't get to Midville, Plains, or Tifton, hopefully you could get to one of these places. And our whole purpose there is to make it easy for you, but to also let you see how the different cotton varieties will perform in your environment. We, as I said earlier, target most of our efforts towards school groups. Last year we saw about 4,300 school students. We participate in school days, usually in the spring, and also have worked with some gens on some different programs. And anytime any of you have a need for someone to talk about cotton, please call the commission and we'll do what we can to make sure that we have somebody there. This past year we met with we hosted a luncheon for the State House Ag and Consumer Affairs Committee. We then went to Washington and met with our delegation. We felt it was important to be there because we had some new members and certainly wanted to start building our relationships with them. And our delegation is great and they work hard for us, and we really appreciate what they do. We had a congressional staff tour this year. We had 10 of our offices. Both our senators, ag LAs, were there. We started off at Swift Spinning up in Columbus, and they're a yarn spinner by a lot of Georgia cotton. And we started from the end, you know, from the manufacturing end. Then we went over to, went over to Ronnie Lee's farm, and he was able to show him his farm in operation. All the staffers got to ride in a cotton picker and pick a few rows of cotton. He also showed them his gin in operation. We then went to Chickasha of Georgia. Here's Andy Borum. He's the head person there, and he spoke to them about the need for cotton seed assistance and also explained how Chickasha does business and how important the cotton seed program is to our cotton farmers. We also went to the Stripling Irrigation Center. Obviously, we got members in our delegation who are not or don't have much row cropping or no row cropping in their districts, but water is something that's going to come to the attention of every one of their members. And Calvin Perry, Wes Porter, they put on a tremendous program and certainly impressed me, and I'm sure the staffers as to what a good job they're doing and how we're making efforts to conserve as much water and be environmentally responsible as possible. We also went by board member Stephen Meeks's farm. Stephen grows tobacco and other crops, and we try to show them not only cotton but a little bit of other agriculture. Policy updates. We've heard all these things. We know things are tough right now. Reese Langley's going to talk to you in a few minutes and explain, you know, what the Cotton Council's doing. But the bottom line is it's hard to play when you don't have the cards dealt to you. The WTO case dictated that there would be no target price or PLC program for cotton. Insurance was basically our only option. Stacks in its original form was going to cover 70 to 95% of revenue with a reference price of 65 cents. And also, the one good thing about stacks is that 80% premium subsidy is the highest of any insurance product. Stacks finally passed with a coverage of 70 to 90. We didn't get that 95% coverage that we were asking for. And we went to a regular insurance reference price, which was down from that 65 cents, but we did keep the, fortunate enough to keep the premium subsidy. And we were able to keep the marketing loan despite our friends in Brazil's objections to it. And one more comment about the WTO. We make sure we hammer to our congressional delegation. We see what the WTO has done to our commodity. We are hammering on them to make China and India particularly become compliant with WTO at this point. They're not. They're paying their farmers subsidy at least twice the level of what you're getting, and that's very market distorting, and we've got to ask our government to get those folks to stop that, and let's level the playing field back up. The cotton seed, one of the programs that's being worked on is the cotton seed being declared an other oil seed. Secretary Vilsack has the authority to do that in the farm bill. If he will allow it, it'll be the procedure will be very prescriptive as to how he should implement it, and we're working on it. Our delegation is hopefully going to meet with him and talk about it and let him know the dire need that we have for it. The reference price is at $403 a ton, and we are not asking for a marketing loan. We only want the PLC ARC program. We have had great success. We've had a letter writing campaign from banks. We had a great showing from Georgia, and the cooperation of our bankers associations and local banks have been really great, and we appreciate it. We had 100 congressmen sign on the letter to Senator Vilsack and 19 senators, and the secretary last in the last couple of weeks stated he had some legal and some trade concerns about it, but so far no news is good news because that means he hasn't turned it down. Future concerns of cotton industry, you can see that red trend line there. Cotton consumption continues to go up. Unfortunately, look here in 2010, you see that big price spike we had, and look what happened here. Not a good sign, but two reasons for the reason that causes me concern is that price spike, we lost space on spinning frames. Consumer demand is when folks have money, they're going to buy clothes and whatever, and our promotional program will deal with that. But getting space back on the spinning frames and getting the manufacturers to use more cotton in their manufacturing process is something that's real important. This is, I think, a good example of what happened. I know Barry Worsham will talk to you a little bit more about this in detail, but look in 2006 or 7. Everybody had 8.2 pairs of jeans. Look where we are over here in 2012, 6.7. Folks, if that two pair of blue jeans, if everybody had two more pair of blue jeans, we would not be here today talking about 60-something cent cotton. We would all be smiling and doing a heck of a lot better. Y'all should be receiving very soon, if you haven't already, every three your ballots for our continuation referendum. You'll have 30 days to vote, and every 3 years, producers have the opportunity to vote on our commission and other commission. We hope that y'all will continue to have confidence as we enter our 51st year and working on behalf of cotton and the surrounding industries in Georgia. And if y'all have any questions or whatever, please contact us. And particularly, we don't want you to contact us and pat us on the back. We'd like for you to contact us and tell us what y'all need for us to do. And we appreciate the opportunity to work on y'all's behalf. And between the staff and the board, we work for you and appreciate that opportunity.
Good morning. I've got the opportunity to introduce our next speaker, Reese Langley. Reese was named the Vice President of Washington Operations for the National Cotton Council in October 2014. In this role, he is responsible for coordinating the Washington activities of the Council, including working with Congress and the administration with the overall mission of helping each of the U.S. cotton industry's seven segments compete effectively and profitably in a global market. Prior to joining the council, Reese served for nearly 10 years as the Vice President of Government Affairs for the USA Rice Federation, and that is the trade association representing rice producers, millers, merchants, and allied businesses. Before that, he spent a few years working as the Agriculture LA for Representative Terry Everett from Alabama. Reese was born and raised on his family farm in Athens, Alabama, where he still remains involved today. He earned a bachelor's degree in ag economics, followed by an MBA from Auburn University. And he and his wife, Carrie, have one son and reside in Alexandria, Virginia, where they're active members of the First Baptist Church of Alexandria. And when I was in Washington, I had the opportunity of working with Reese while he was with the Rice organization. And he did a tremendous job for them in the almost year and a half he's been on with the Cotton Council. He's had a lot of challenges, but he's done a tremendous job for us, and we look forward to him representing us in Washington for several years. So please join me in welcoming Reese to the stage.
Thank you, Matt, for that very kind introduction, and I really appreciate the opportunity to be here with you this morning and visit and talk a little bit about some of the work that the National Cotton Council is doing. And really appreciate the support and the opportunity to work with Richie and all of his staff at the Georgia Cotton Commission. What I'd like to do is really focus on two main areas this morning, a little bit about what we can expect from Congress between now and, say, mid-July before things kind of end as far as congressional work and all the focus at that point shifts to the elections this fall, coming up in November. So we've got a few months here where Congress will try to get some work done this year, and we'll talk about some of those issues and things that we as an industry need to be focused on. And then I'll spend most of the time talking about some of the key legislative and regulatory issues that the Council worked on in 2015 and what we're focused on now for this year. As far as the agenda in Congress, a few of the things that they have to do and are likely to do this year. One, they'll pass a congressional budget resolution. And that is not concerning, but what may be concerning to us is if they take that one step further and try to pass what's called a budget reconciliation bill. That's legislation that could actually result in budget cuts to programs like the Farm Bill and crop insurance. And that's where we want to be very focused and very diligent in making sure we can protect those programs from any further budget cuts if this reconciliation process plays out. Secondly, Congress will have to pass their annual appropriations bills, including the agriculture bill. And in that bill, there are a number of priorities for our industry that we want to make sure get funded. And I'll talk about that in a little bit more detail in a moment. There's also the potential for Congress to try to pass the recently concluded Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP, trade agreement. Most likely that will not come up until sometime after the November elections. So there's talk that that could occur in the lame duck session of Congress at the end of this year, or it could spill over into 2017. And then we think there'll be a beginning of the discussion about trying to do comprehensive tax reform. Now that certainly won't happen this year because it's an election year, but we do think the committees that deal with this issue will start to lay the groundwork and have some discussion and do some activities to try to be prepared for that for 2017. Now some of the agriculture specific issues that we'll be working on and that Congress will be involved in. One, I think we can expect to see a lot more oversight of EPA and some of the other regulatory activities that this administration is involved in. And certainly that is needed given what we're seeing occur at EPA when it comes to pesticides and other issues. And we'll talk about those in more detail. There's also an effort to try to pass a biotech labeling law. The House passed that bill last year. So far, they've been unable to get a similar bill passed through the Senate. But there's an effort underway now with USDA involved to try to negotiate some compromise between the two different sides in this debate. And if that can happen, then I think we can see some final legislation get passed this year to address how biotech or GMO products have to be labeled. One of the other things that Congress needs to do, and this is something that's in the Ag Committee jurisdiction, is to reauthorize the Commodity Exchange Act. This is the legislation that regulates and governs the Commodity Futures Trading Commission, which is the federal agency that oversees the commodity futures markets. And so we think that will happen at some point this year as well. Now, looking ahead at some of the legislative and regulatory issues that we've been focused on, Richie talked about it a moment ago, but what's been going on with respect to trying to get USDA to implement a cottonseed policy. So this issue moved through the National Cotton Council's policy setting process this past summer, and by September we were starting to lay out activities and a strategy to try to get USDA to make this cottonseed designation. And as Richie mentioned, that's included some congressional letters where we had a very good response, including from most of the Georgia congressional delegation. The lender letters have carried a lot of weight with USDA. But as Richie noted, what we're facing at this point is Secretary Vilsack and others at USDA are trying to claim that they think there are legal hurdles or reasons that prevent them from making this designation. Now, we think this farm bill and previous farm bills are very clear in the authority that it grants to USDA to do this. The other things that are factoring into how USDA views this issue, one is the budget implication and what the program would cost and how it's paid for. And then the other thing is on the international trade front. Given that we've resolved and settled the Brazil WTO case, USDA is thinking about, okay, does this potentially open the U.S. up to another WTO challenge from Brazil or another country? So all of those things are factoring into how USDA is viewing this. The positive thing so far at this point is we think, given all of the congressional pressure, the pressure from the industry, and just the ability to highlight for USDA the severe situation and the economic situation in the cotton industry, we believe Secretary Vilsack and others have recognized that something has to be done to help the industry in the short term. And so we're continuing to pursue the cottonseed policy, continuing to try to keep pressure on USDA to take action on that, and we'll continue that focus. But in addition to that, we think that regardless of what occurs short term on cottonseed, that USDA is going to be able to try to figure out a way to do something short term to help the cotton industry. In short term, I'm talking about this year, this crop year. We don't know any details or specifics on what that is, what it may look like, or the amount of funding we're talking about, but we think things are moving in a positive direction to be able to provide some assistance. And so we're certainly very focused on that. That's our top priority as we move through the next few weeks and try to get some more clarity from USDA. And I would just add that we have a number of congressional champions on Capitol Hill that are helping to pursue this and are really doing a tremendous job on behalf of the industry. Another issue to talk about is relative to the marketing loan program and how that functions, and specifically the ability to use marketing certificates. So the authority for marketing certificates had been in place for a number of years up until the 2008 Farm Bill, and that bill took away the ability for USDA to offer certificates. And the reason we need marketing certificates is when you're dealing with cotton prices where they are today, below the loan rate, and you're generating marketing loan benefits, under this 2014 Farm Bill, all of the payment limits for the different programs were combined into one overall limit. So when you're participating in ARC or PLC on other crops that are counting toward that limit, and then you have marketing loan benefits as well that get counted towards it, it can become an issue. The other thing is having marketing certificates really helps the flow of cotton and helps the marketing loan program to function as it's intended, helps to make sure we don't have any forfeitures of the commodity to USDA. And so it was imperative that we get marketing certificates back. And we were able to do that in 2015, working through the agriculture appropriations process. It was included in the final bill. People like Chairman Adderholt from Alabama, Chairman Cochran from Mississippi, Senator Moran from Kansas, they really carried the water on this issue and made sure that this happened. And so we're at a point now with USDA where we think they're within 1 or 2 weeks of being ready to implement certificates again and roll that out, and we expect them to operate and function very similar to how they did when they were last available in 2008. Another issue that recently came out of USDA is the new actively engaged in farming regulation. So this is a rulemaking that the 2014 Farm Bill required USDA to undertake. And essentially it said that USDA had to look at the current requirements of what is considered to be actively engaged in the farming operation when you're only providing management. You can provide labor or management to be qualified. And this is really focused on trying to tighten up that management requirement. So USDA issued their final rule in mid-December. Some of the key things to keep in mind: one, Congress made sure in what they included in the Farm Bill is that any changes in this area would not impact family operations. So if you only have family members involved, then none of these changes should apply. But if, in addition to your family members, you have an outside, someone else involved that's only providing management, then, and you're going to have more than one individual that qualifies with only management, then there are certain criteria that this rule puts in place. It says to be able to add that second individual, you have to be considered a large farm, which they view as 2,500 acres or more. And then if you want to add a third person, you have to be large as well as complex, which they define complex as things like growing multiple crops, operating in a larger geographic area, having some type of value added or additional processing operation on the farm, that type thing. So there are a lot of criteria that are put around this, but in no case can you have more than three individuals that are not family members that are providing only management and being eligible for the farm programs. As far as when this takes effect, it goes into effect for the 2016 crop year unless you planted a fall seeded crop in 2015. So last fall, if you planted wheat, for example, then this would not take effect for your farm until the 2017 crop year, because they didn't feel like they could make this change when you already had a crop in the ground. Now we'll talk a little bit about crop insurance and stacks specifically. So this shows you for the 2015 crop year, the stacks policies that were sold. I've got Georgia circled here. You can see about 2,200 policies, the second largest state after Texas as far as stacks participation. And then this shows you the actual numbers, 2,300 policies actually in Georgia. Nearly 20% of all the policies in the U.S., stacks policies, were in Georgia. And then you compare that to 9,300 underlying policies on cotton, which is about 11% of the total in the U.S. So that just gives you an idea of how many policies in the state added stacks coverage. Now, as we look ahead to this year, there are a few other changes that are coming from RMA specific to stacks. One of those is, and this is something we heard a lot about last year, is wanting to provide producers the ability to make separate purchase decisions between your irrigated and non-irrigated acreage on stacks. In 15, you had to buy it on all of your acres, regardless. For this year and going forward, you'll be able to separate out those purchasing decisions between your irrigated and non-irrigated. You can also, this year, purchase the cottonseed endorsement or the cottonseed rider on stacks, which you could not do that last year. And then also, we had some issues in certain counties last year where you had a relatively small number of cotton acres and underlying policies were only available through written agreements from RMA and the insurance companies. And so this year, you can actually add stacks in those counties as well. Now, I mentioned earlier the appropriations process. So this shows you the priorities for our industry that we need to make sure are funded each year. There's the APHIS funding for the boll weevil and pink bollworm eradication programs to try to continue that work in the parts of the Cotton Belt where that activity is ongoing. For the current year, we got $11.5 million for those programs, and that will be our request for 2016 as well. There's also the market development and market promotion programs that USDA operates to help promote ag products in our export markets. There's two key programs there that total about $235 million. Cotton Council International each year accesses about $20 million of that. That is the core budget for CCI to be able to do their marketing and promotion activities around the world. And so it's critical that we maintain that funding, that overall amount, and make sure CCI continues to get its appropriate share. We've also so far been able to maintain funding for the three Ag Research Service ginning labs that are operated across the Cotton Belt. And then, as I mentioned earlier, we'll want to make sure we can prevent any damaging amendments from coming up through the appropriations bill, things that could tighten up payment limits, cut crop insurance, or make other damaging changes to the Farm Bill programs. A couple of notes here on tax issues. You know, we've been through a cycle where for the last few years, Congress waits until they get to December to decide what to do on some of these issues like the Section 179 expensing, bonus depreciation. So finally this year, even though it didn't happen until December, Congress was able to pass legislation that made permanent the Section 179 expensing provision, and it set that at $500,000, and then it phases out at the $2 million level, and those amounts are indexed to inflation. So that gives you some certainty going forward on that provision. Now on the bonus depreciation, this same legislation set that at 50% for 2015, 16, and 17, and then it phases down in 18 and 19. Congress was not able to come up with the funding necessary to make the bonus depreciation permanent at 50%. But at least this gives you a little more certainty than that year-to-year process that we had been stuck in. Now on the trade front, Richie talked about the results and the implications from the WTO case that Brazil brought, and we lost that case. Unfortunately, as the WTO negotiations continue, and they're certainly not making very much progress, but every time there's a meeting of the WTO parties that's related to agriculture, the issue of U.S. cotton policy continues to come up. We continue to be scrutinized by the West African cotton producing countries and other countries that continue to want to claim that somehow U.S. cotton policies are harming them or disenfranchising them and their ability to produce cotton. We know that's not the case, and I think as an industry we've finally been able to convince our trade negotiators that the policies today in the U.S. for cotton and the dynamics of the global cotton market today are not what they were a decade ago. The U.S. is not in the same position as it was then. Today, as we all know, the major players are China and India and what they're doing with their policies. And that's where our focus has to be, and that's where our trade negotiators have to keep pressure on. And I think finally we're starting to see the ship turn on that, and I think we're moving into a better place. Also, mid-year last year, Congress passed Trade Promotion Authority. That is what gave this administration the ability to conclude the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which they did in October. During that process, there was an effort as part of the TPA bill to try to make some changes that would have been very harmful to what's left of our domestic textile industry here in the U.S. And fortunately, thanks to the work of Senator Isaacson and others that are involved in those trade committees, we were able to prevent that from happening. And then also this year, we finally saw Congress reauthorize the federal entity known as the Export-Import Bank. That's an important entity for a lot of our textile companies that are exporting their products. This helps provide financing for those activities. And we were able to get that reauthorized through 2019. Also on the trade front, I mentioned China and India. So specifically what we're seeing is China in their western province, where a majority of their cotton is produced, they're operating a target price program of $1.40 a pound. And then you look at India, they have what they call a minimum support price of about 70 to 80 cents a pound. So certainly support levels well above current cotton prices, well above support levels in the U.S. India in 2015, for the first time, became the largest cotton producing country. They're the second largest exporter. So obviously a key competitor of ours. And as I mentioned, we are having to make sure and try to do more to get our trade negotiators to keep the focus on what China and India are doing and insist that since they are also part of the WTO, they need to be notifying what they're doing with respect to policy, and they need to be transparent in how they're operating these programs. And if they're not in compliance, then they need to be held accountable so that we can help address this situation. Also, on a related note, we're continuing to deal with an anti-dumping case that the government of Turkey brought against the U.S. In October of 14 is when that started. And this case has dragged on. A number of our cotton exporting companies have been caught up in that and have had to spend a lot of resources to respond and defend themselves. The Cotton Council has been involved as well. And we expect to see a final decision on this within the next 2 to 3 months, and certainly doing all we can to make sure that these anti-dumping duties are not placed on U.S. cotton going into Turkey, which continues to be a key export market for us. And finally, I want to talk about a few of the regulatory issues that we're dealing with. As you all know, we've been working now for well over a year to try to get EPA approval for the use of two products on cotton varieties that have either the dicamba trait or the 2,4-D tolerant trait. And both of these new cotton varieties have been approved by USDA for planting. And as you know, some of the seeds were available in 15 and they will be this year. But EPA has yet to give the approval to apply these herbicides over the top of those new varieties. And that continues to be the holdup to get that approval out of EPA, ideally in time for use this growing season. We're also seeing an issue that is playing out through the court system where they have challenged the Dow technology, this Enlist Duo, and has forced EPA to go back and take a second look at their registration of this product and whether or not it's going to be made available or continue to be made available. And then we have the process that EPA goes through to register or re-register a lot of these pesticides. And we've seen just in 2015 several examples where EPA has really allowed the environmental community to work through the court system to force EPA to withdraw or to not renew the registration of some of these critical products. And so it's just a very concerning trend that we see at EPA where they're essentially allowing regulation to occur through the courts rather than through the EPA process. And that's something we're continuing to fight and push back against, but unfortunately don't see that changing a lot until we see a new administration. We also have the issue that's ongoing related to pollinators and how the class of pesticides known as neonicotinoids or neonics impact pollinators. And those are some critical pesticides that are used in the cotton industry that we need to maintain access to. The other issue, the Waters of the U.S. regulation, as you know, there have been efforts in Congress to try to overturn this and require EPA to withdraw that rulemaking. However, when the legislation gets to the White House, the president vetoes it. So again, until we see a different administration, I don't think we're going to see legislation be successful to deal with this. However, there are court cases that are ongoing, and because of that, EPA cannot regulate or implement WOTUS in any of the states while those court cases are ongoing. Just a couple of slides here as we look ahead to the elections and the current makeup of Congress. Now, this shows you Republican and Democratic breakdown in both the House and Senate. Obviously, in the House, not really close between Republican and Democrats. It would take about a 30-seat swing from Republicans to Democrats for them to retake the House. So I don't think anyone is predicting that to happen. But if you look at the Senate, it would only take about a five-seat swing from Republicans to Democrats to see a change of control. And the fact that this year Republicans are having to defend 24 Senate seats, Democrats only 10. So things could get tighter in the Senate. Certainly something that is worth watching and see how that plays out in some of the key Senate elections that are taking place. A couple of other things to mention as far as some key changes that we saw late last year. We have a new Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan from Wisconsin. He has previously been chair of the House Ways and Means Committee. Before that, he was chair of the Budget Committee. He has some very strong views on trying to balance the budget and trying to cut programs, things like the Farm Bill and crop insurance. Those were his views when he was a committee chairman. We still have concerns about how he's going to view these programs in his new role as Speaker, but we do believe that people like Chairman Conaway of the House Ag Committee have developed a very, very good relationship with the Speaker, and I think he's going to have to take a broader view of things now that he's in that leadership position. And then we do have a new chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, Kevin Brady from Texas. I think that's a good thing, given that he's from Texas, a key cotton-producing state, and again, some of the relationships that other members from the Cotton Belt have with him. And that's a very key position, since this committee deals with all trade issues and all tax issues. And then finally, just to talk a little bit about the Georgia delegation, if you look at this list, you see that Georgia is very fortunate in having so many members of your delegation serving in very key committee roles. If you start with the House Ag Committee, you have three representatives, two of those obviously from cotton producing districts in Georgia, but also David Scott, who doesn't have any cotton in his district, but has been a long time very strong supporter of our industry and our issues, all three on the Ag Committee. And then on the Agriculture Appropriations Committee, Sanford Bishop, a very senior member of that committee and very instrumental in funding for a lot of our key programs. And then on the Senate side, with the Ag Committee, freshman Senator Perdue, who is being very active and doing a great job on that committee, and then also Senator Isaacson on the Senate Finance Committee. And that, again, is very important because that committee deals with all trade and tax issues. So he is a key advocate for us on that committee when it comes to all the trade challenges that we're facing as an industry. With that, I want to thank you for your support for the National Cotton Council, for your engagement and everything that you do. The advocacy work that we do on behalf of the industry could not be successful if it weren't for you being involved and being active, and just really appreciate you for all that support and be happy to take any questions if there's time. So the question was on the cottonseed policy, if it gets enacted, would it be retroactive starting with 2015 and going forward? As we have pursued this and talked with USDA and others, that's been our position, that we feel like it should at least start with 2015. We can't predict what would happen, but that's at least what we're advocating. Yes, sir. Other questions? Okay, well, thank you again very much.
Thank you, Reese. Good morning. I have the privilege to introduce our next speaker. J. Barry Worsham is President and Chief Executive Officer of Cotton Incorporated, the research and marketing company representing U.S. Upland Cotton. In his post, Mr. Worsham oversees the company's global research and marketing programs. Research programs are managed primarily from the company's world headquarters in Cary, North Carolina, while marketing programs are centralized in the New York office. The company also has offices in New Mexico, Osaka, Hong Kong, and Shanghai to provide expertise and service to the textile industries in these regions. Mr. Worsham joined Cotton Incorporated in 1983 as manager, Cotton Analysis. He also served as director, fiber and economic analysis director, marketing research, vice president, corporate planning and program development, and most recently, executive vice president and chief operating officer. Before joining Cotton Incorporated, Mr. Worsham was senior vice president analyst of JIK Racing, Wisconsin. Mr. Worsham is member of the advisory board for the Department of Textile Products Industry and Marketing at the University of North Carolina at Greensboro School of Human and Environmental Science. A 1978 graduate of the University of North Carolina with a BS in Business Administration, Mr. Worsham received his MBA from UNC Greensboro in 1979. Mr. Worsham and his family reside in Cary, North Carolina. Join me in giving Mr. Worsham a warm welcome.
Thank you, Bart. I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. And also, thanks for the leadership that Georgia has provided the research and promotion programs, whether you're talking about Cotton Incorporated or the Cotton Board, both. I've had former chairman here, Louis Perry, and the newest officer of Cotton Incorporated is Van Murphy. So we have four officers on our board of directors. And Van has joined us as of, I think, January 1 of this year, and we look forward to working with Van. He's a great guy and been around the program for a long time. What I'm going to talk about today is a lot about what we're working on, some of the challenge facing us, what we've been working on in 2015, and kind of how we see things going as far as some trends for 2016. Some of these things have already been talked about, but I just want to reiterate. These are some of the hurdles that we were looking at in 2015 that still exist today. We've had, independent of price, some fashion trends that have been favoring the synthetic fibers. As cheap as the price of cotton is today, actually the price of synthetic fibers are even cheaper. You're talking about 50-cent polyester in Asia. We've seen the areas where the biggest growth in the apparel market, which is where cotton competes, has been activewear, things that, think about the Under Armour type products. That tends not to be favorable to cotton. You saw Richie talk about the ownership of denim. Well, denim is one of the largest markets for cotton, And it, not only is it a big market in terms of the number of units, but it's a big market in terms of the weight. I'd rather have somebody wearing a pair of denim jeans than a pair of even 100% cotton yoga pants, because denim is going to wear a lot, weigh a lot more, and it's going to be more pounds, which is what we're growing. We've had to deal with some environmental perception challenges. That's where Cotton Leeds is coming in. We'll talk about it a little later. Budget constraints, like all organizations, have been affected by that. And also the weaker global economy has meant that we have not seen the kind of robust overall demand for textile fibers as we would normally see, and that puts challenge on the demand for cotton. So one of the ones that's not talked about that I want to just kind of show you up front is we've been doing a lot of work on, well, you know, we grow cotton, we grow it in terms of weight, but we sell it in terms of units. And the weight of those units can change, and we were able to go back to 2006 and look at the average weight sort of cotton-dominant apparel versus synthetics, and we were really interested to find what a downward trend we'd seen up through 2014 in terms of cotton. What this means is the same number of units in 2006 would require about, say, 10 to 12% less in terms of fiber grown today. That means products are getting lighter weight, maybe finer yarns and fabrics. And the same is even true for synthetics, although the weight in recent year or so has increased. This has been a big drag on the demand for cotton. We don't have these data worldwide, but certainly we think anecdotally this is happening in other parts of the world as well. And you know, if you lose 10% just on the basis of weight, in terms of a global thing, that'd be over a global analysis, that'd be over 10 million bales of cotton that could be potentially at risk, or was at risk, due to this just changing fashion trend. The good news is we've seen that stabilize a little bit and actually begin to turn up, and that's something we just stabilization would help us quite a bit going forward. Some of the strategies we've employed is we want to revamp our consumer campaign. Fabric of Our Lives was great. It tended to reinforce behavior. We need consumers to do something different today. Of course, the world's changing. Social media is the way to reach younger people. They're the ones making a lot of decisions in terms of fashion and the trends there. We've got to increase the technology adoptions for cotton. If you go in the marketplace today and you want to buy clothing, almost everything has a label that claims that the product does something. Yeah, it either wrinkles less, it wicks away moisture, it's waterproof, it does this, that, and the other. Because there's so much out there, that's the way these retailers are trying to compete. We have to improve cotton sustainability image, provide more defensible data and information on why cotton is a better choice. That's the question I ask my staff all the time. If we're going to go into a brand and retailer and some senior person is going to give us the time of day to talk about cotton, what argument are we going to make that cotton is a better choice? It can't just be on the fact, well, cotton prices are down. Well, that helps, of course, in terms of making an argument. But we've got to do a better job of communicating as to why they should rethink it. We've got to improve grower solutions and communications of relevant technologies, especially when you're in this lower price environment. I'll talk about that later. So the campaign changed just a few months ago from basically the fabric of our lives communication. That's still a core message that we have. But a lot of consumer research went into this campaign, and we said we're trying to communicate why cotton is better. So the campaign is called It's Your Favorite for a Reason. We don't use celebrities anymore. We don't have the funds to do that. We'll call it real people talking about their stories in terms of fashion and the kind of products they like, and particularly why they like their cotton fabric. So we've got to get people to start thinking about checking the label before they buy again. We do a lot of testing on our commercials, like how many times people see it, what percentage of the population sees it. This is just one example, women 18 to 34. In TV, we can reach them about 13 times a year, 81% of that population demographic. In digital, which is all internet, social media, all that combined, we're actually able to reach 63% of them, almost 10 times. There's some overlap here, but if you combine them, typically we can get about 90% of the population about 18 times with a message about cotton. And the challenge for us going forward as the cost of media continues to increase and the budgets that we have in these next couple of years are going to be under pressure, we've got to find more efficient ways of reaching the consumer and increasing the sharpness of that message
that we want people to take away. We've been tracking the recognition of the program. It's only been out for less than a year. Basically, we've seen that increase in almost all categories in terms of how we look at it, male, female, younger, older. It's particularly up in terms of the female audience, those that tend to be more fashion forward. This is sort of a schematic of how we look at the world today. You know, in the old days, we'll call it, we basically did television. You do some print advertising for your trade, and that was pretty much it. Well, today you've got to have television because that's still important, but that's just kind of a hub. You've got to, from that, you've got to have some digital, whether it's Pinterest or Twitter, or we've got Facebook. We're pretty much in every space, and we're even doing some online type partnering with actual retailers to help them promote cotton products. In most cases, you got to have younger people that are involved in this. I'm not exactly somebody that's on Facebook all the time or Twitter, but if you want to reach young people, that's where you got to be. Digital, one of the things we use to measure that, one of the industry metrics for digital is, that could be, running a commercial you click on a site, you get a commercial before you can continue. The question is, what completion rate do you have, and how does that compare with your benchmarks? There's a lot of data on this industry-wide. Typically, you get about a 65% click-through rate on a promotion. We get about 75%. So we're higher than the benchmark. A little over a year ago, we were right at or even slightly below our benchmark. So we've really increased our click-through rate, which is good. It means that people are paying attention longer. We talked about this in the last couple of meetings I've been at, is the issue of yoga pants. That's a negative thing for cotton. You may like seeing people in yoga pants, but it's not a good thing for cotton. At least it hasn't been, for two reasons. Number one, a lot of that stuff is synthetic, but also it tends to replace denim. And as I said before, a denim jean is going to weigh a lot more than a pair of yoga pants. And if you combine that with the fact that even if we got 100% cotton in yoga pants, we're going to be losing out. And so at least one of the things we recognize is we've got to do a better job of penetrating some of these markets. One of the ways we can do it, besides just having products available, is to get people to think about it when they Google. Everybody goes on Google now to find something before you get serious about looking for something. So if somebody were to Google your favorite yoga pants, we actually pay for this set to come up early. It would say your favorite yoga pants, the fabric of our lives.com. Somebody could click on that. They could find out more about opportunities for cotton in that particular market. We've got some analytics going right now, and there's early indications that this paid media type of search media is actually a pretty good buy for us, and we may be doing more of that in relative terms as budgets shrink. In terms of how we reach our trade, when we talk about trade, we're talking about brands and retailers, not necessarily consumers. One of the things we have to change is how they view cotton. Is cotton viewed as just an old fiber that's good for underwear, T-shirts, and maybe denim, or can cotton be something different? So the focus of our trade campaign has been cotton and technology, about how cotton has evolved over the years, how you can add finishes to cotton to allow it to do things like wick away moisture or keep you waterproof, or antimicrobials, wrinkle-resistant technologies. There's quite a bit that can be done with cotton. So again, the campaign is going to be discover what cotton can do. It's all part of that cotton is more than you think. As I said, we've actually partnered with online retailers. I didn't know who this group was, but kids did. It's called Rue La La. If you go online, they're one of these shopping sites that has good merchandise, but only for a limited period. They'll run specials. So we partnered with them, and four times a year, the only thing they offer is cotton. And so we can use that as a platform to see whether or not if they think that has worked very well for them. They use cotton signage. We've had a celebrity spokesman within Rue La La to help us out there. If we have the metrics to support the fact that things were good when they had those events, we can then take that information to other brands and retailers to say, look, when people have done cotton-rich type promotions, their sales have gone up, and we can use this again to help leverage that with other brands and retailers, whether they're selling online or not. We have to have a better story in terms of the environment. Richie talked about that, and it's not just about the environment in terms of growing cotton or even processing cotton, but what happens to it at the end of life. The synthetics will sometimes tell you that they've got a recycling story, that they take plastic bottles and they convert it into textile products. They don't really say that it's not a continuous loop. But denim is a big product, and it gets a lot of negative press in terms of environmental issues, in terms of producing it. But we have found in over the years that there's an organization that actually converts that denim product into home insulation. It can be recycled. It could go into home insulation and be used for long periods of time. It's not the cheapest insulation product, but it does work very well. And we started a program with Habitat for Humanity several years ago about we'll help people collect it. This company will recycle it, donate it to Habitat for Humanity. We can get some positive press out of it. Again, it's a good story about cotton. Well, Cheryl Crow, we had a board member that had a connection with her, to her. She's in a cotton, or grew up in a cotton region. I think she has a family that's connected to cotton in some way. And we asked her, would she be willing to help us out? And she was. She actually came down to New Orleans, did some of the work with Habitat for Humanity in terms of building some homes, but did a lot of video for us as well to promote it free of charge. She only had one stipulation. She wasn't going to sing. But nevertheless, she did do a good job of promoting the product and putting cotton in a very positive image. You can see her with the insulation and the T-shirt. It had cotton on it. We work with CCI, as Reese talked about, the importance of maintaining the CCI funding from a regulatory standpoint. Cotton Incorporated is the largest contributor to CCI. One of the programs that we do have jointly is a promotion program within China to promote more demand within China. You know, we need that, all those inventory that have been talked about or will be talked about in China to be soaked up. Anything that we can do to absorb that is going to be good for cotton in the long term. This program was called Mian Is. It's really just about what cotton can do for your life. In our we don't have the funds of a McDonald's or others that we can spend $50-100 million just on one marketing campaign. A lot of what's happened in the last several years was driven not by the consumer but by the retailer. So continuing to have a presence with brands and retailers is so important. In the past year, our supply chain marketing group met with about 750 meetings with nearly 500 companies in 30 countries. And what we're doing there is talking to them about cotton technologies. We're doing licensing agreement with the technologies so that they can use it in their cotton products. It's help them with marketing of cotton, in some cases keeping them in cotton. Maybe they're thinking of moving to a blend in some cases. We can show them how to do this in 100% cotton or mostly cotton. And one of the focuses, along with CCI in this past year, many of the things we do jointly, has been on the activewear market, where cotton initially lost a lot of market share. So if we're talking, in trade shows, like I forgot where this was, probably in Asia somewhere, a key focus of us was try to brand cotton in this area, this active area. So we have our own active. We talk about enhanced engineering and embellished cotton. We have a lot of products and fabrics that we can support those claims with and get people interested. Actually, of all things, activewear in men's was the one area that we saw a little bit of an uptick in market share this past year from a very low level. But nevertheless, we're seeing more interest in using a little more cotton in this particular area. And this is important not just from the standpoint of activewear, but activewear, the attributes within this market actually move to other areas as well. So it kind of has a spillover effect. So we've got to stem the tide. We've got to stop the bleeding and get something going positively in this market to help us in other markets to compete. We do it in a number of ways. We have our fashion people actually develop trend forecasts in this market. We have actually developed garments, actual garments, not just fabrics, that can show brands and retailers how cotton can be used. Maybe in some cases, it might be a blend. It may be a blend with some technology added. But anyway, just showing them how cotton can compete at hopefully at a reasonable price with the synthetics. These are the types of companies we work with in that market. You guys are familiar with these, VF, North Face. The women would know Lululemon and Ralph Lauren and others. There's many players in this particular market. One of the things that we have discovered is a lot of times companies use the technologies, but they do a lousy job in some cases of actually marketing what they have. So one of the focuses we'll have this coming year, in this the second half of last year, was just developing our own marketing materials that basically show a brand or retailer, if you adopt this, here's some effective ways that you can market it. This is what you have. Not just slap a label on it and throw it out there and mark it up as a price, but what advantage does cotton have? So we're always looking for what story can we tell, and from a marketing side, why cotton? What's the advantage of cotton? Denim is an important market, even though that market is in total has smaller today than it was in relative terms 5, 6, 7 years ago. It's still very important for cotton. The fabrics in this market have gotten lighter. You have to have more innovation in denim than we've had in the past. And so we continue to show, again, the brands and retailers all kinds of options in that market, whether it's 100% cotton or in some cases it might have a little bit of blend to add things like stretch and other characteristics. The challenge for us sometimes is there's so many brands and retailers out there. How can we reach, with only a staff total of 145 people, how can we reach all the people in the world that we would like to reach? And of course, you can't reach everybody you'd like to, but one of the ways you can be more efficient at it is if you can develop a site of some kind of education materials where people will actually go to that for information. The growers pay, in terms of research and promotion, pay for about half of our budget, and half of it actually comes from the importers of yarns, fabrics, finished goods, primarily the brands, retailers, JCPenney's and Walmart's and others. They pay for half of our budget. And they've been influential in terms of setting up a program which we call Cotton University. This is not for the general public. This is really more for the industry people. About where could they go to find out everything they need to know about cotton to help them in their business? And so it got started with workshops. It spread into something called Cotton University. And this thing has really taken off. This past year, we had about 14,000, 13,500 people on the site. It's about a 40% increase just in the last year or so. Almost 2,000 companies. We keep track of how many new visitors we have. Typically, they go on the site. They stay on there for about 8 minutes, which is very high. And it's an efficient way of communicating all the things we want to talk about. If they want to go on site in terms about how do I deal with shrinkage? What do I need to look for? How do I deal? Tell me more about denim manufacturing and what I should look for. How do I control color retention or whatever the issue may be? Environment, sustainability, what's happening with cotton? But it's a more efficient way as opposed to just trying to do one-on-one meetings. This started from technical workshops. Several years ago, we were asked by the brands, retailers, to hold workshops for the industry to teach them about cotton. Typically, we'll do about 50 a year, about 10 in our office in Cary, 28 are regional, about 12 international. We can get about 1,800 people. These are actual people that are making decisions in the industry to attend these. We've had about 20 topics or so, 175 brands and retailers. If you look at a bale of cotton, you ask yourself, where does my cotton go? About 80% of your cotton is going to go to clothing, apparel. Maybe a little less than 20% is going to go into home fabrics, towels and sheets and those kind of products. And just a couple percent are going to go into other markets like non-wovens or industrial type products. Non-wovens we consider things like diapers and other end uses. Well, these markets are large markets for other fibers. So we're always looking to see if we can get a little cotton in some of these markets because we need as much offtake as we can. We're too dependent on just the apparel market. We worked in the past year with companies like Target, Walmart, and Amazon, and on basically increasing the cotton content in some diapers. And we think working with in the non-wovens area, there may be some opportunities for cotton in the next 5 years. That's a market where people are beginning to become more interested in what the fiber content is. And we do have a nice story about the natural fibers, and it does touch the skin, so things like bandages and diapers and others, it can be an important important attribute. The big downside to cotton competing in the non-wovens market is that as competitive as the apparel market is in terms of fiber prices, Nonwovens is exponentially more competitive. So it's when you have cheap synthetics, it makes it a little tough to compete. On the plus side, a lot of the synthetics in this market tend to be rayon, and we're a little more closely competitive with rayon than we are with polyester. I've talked about fabric innovations. We do a lot of fabrics every year. We keep track of the requests that we have for them. This past year, we got about 12,000 requests for the fabrics that we have developed. That's up. We've been increasing that over the last several years. So that tells us that the people are becoming a little more interested in cotton. We haven't seen it in the market share numbers yet, but there's certainly an interest in moving to cotton if we can supply the fabrics at a competitive price. Unlike in the past, you know, where we are always focused on everything 100% cotton, about half of our fabrics today are requested that we developed were 100% cotton. We're doing a lot more internally in terms of blends. They're still mostly cotton. The vast majority, you know, probably at least 60% or more is going to be cotton. But in some markets, if we want to get our foot under in the door again, we've got to go with some blends for performance reasons, or maybe it's to lighten the fabric in some cases. So about half of the fabrics that are requested today do contain some other fiber. So we have to be make sure we're experts in that particular area as well. Maybe in some cases it helps us bring the cost down. But nevertheless, still about half of our requests are 100% cotton. We've had some setbacks, not in terms of just you know, market share, but a lot of the technologies that have been developed that are being used for cotton, whether they're developed by Cotton Incorporated or somebody else, some of the chemicals that are used in that are under attack, and in some cases threaten the use of that technology. So one of the things we had to do in this last year or two is step back and look at all the major uses for cotton, some of the technologies going in there, chemistries, and we've got to find solutions to become more environmentally friendly in the processing of cotton and yet still get the performance features. And one of those we're working on right now is from non-formaldehyde finishing for wrinkle-resistant products. There's some buzz in Europe right now that they may ban the formaldehydes in processing. A lot of cotton products that are being sold today, and particularly dress shirts, I think, and slacks, have some kind of wrinkle-resistant finish on it. This has been a tougher challenge than the one we've just overcome, which is non-fluorine chemistry. That was under attack. We do have solutions that are cost-effective and are actually being implemented today. But these are the types of challenges that we face. We send our team all over the world to implement things like trans-dry storm cotton, which is a waterproofing cotton, storm denim, moisture transfer, wicking windows, and one recently that I can't tell you the details, it's confidential, but there was a major retailer that was going to be perhaps getting out of some cotton products because they wanted the products to perform better in terms of abrasion. They were looking at going to some blended products or mostly synthetic. We have this finish called Tough Cotton that we worked with a retailer to see if it could be effective in the markets that they were thinking of pulling out in terms of cotton. It was a big success. I saw a confidential email recently that was shared with me about the performance that from the CEO level said it was excellent and they were going to continue with it. It took a lot of effort overseas with their supply chain, but it's just an example that there's some technologies out there that we can compete. We just got to get that information out there. And it's not always about growing market share, it's about preserving what we have so that we can grow on that. Sustainability, I want to thank everybody who participated in our natural resource survey. We sent, I think, this past year, 2015, about 10% of all growers took the survey. We use that information to document the changes that have taken place in cotton production and how things today are different than they were a decade ago, that we are moving to more sustainable practices. We've reduced the footprint that Richie showed, the spider grams. We can support that information with actual data that's not just national data that we get from you know, the government. So I talked about that. Cotton Leads, Richie talked about that. That's a partnership with the US and Australia. We have about 350 brands, retailers, and mills who are now partners in Cotton Leads, so they know that US is doing good things. These are some of the companies that are part of that. You recognize some of these major brands or mills in the US. Again, we've got to continue to tell that story. At some point, there's a lot of pressures out there for certification programs, and Cotton Leads is not a certification program. We're trying to head that off as best we can, but as you know, that there's other organizations that believe that the way you improve sustainability is a third-party certification, and we would prefer that we don't need that right now. That always adds costs, and the whole chain does not need any unnecessary costs added at this time. Talked about that. Are there signs of optimism with all these negatives? Well, there's some. Fabric weights are stabilizing. We've seen a surge in our fabric requests and technology adoptions. The campaign, we're getting positive feedback. I'm going to just show you a slide or two about a survey we did recently. We're seeing an increase in the request for our seal of cotton. We have some share gains in some markets, but one of the things we looked at this past year, this was back in October, so this was before some economic deterioration has taken place, but we asked the industry, what do you plan to do in terms of use of cotton in the next year? This is a global survey, not just the U.S. Are you planning to use more cotton? And we ask about other fibers as well, in terms of relatively. And in terms of 68% of the industry that we talked to plan to use more cotton in 2016. But the real interesting thing that we found was we asked if you did plan to use more, what was the driving reason? And we were pretty sure that price was going to be the main driver. But to our surprise and satisfaction, consumer demand came up number one. And so how would we use this information? Well, we're going to take this information back to these brands and retailers and say, we're seeing evidence that the consumer is saying they would like more cotton. Your consumer has told you they would like to see more cotton. We're seeing this more in Asia and in the Americas, Latin America, than we are right now in the U.S. But nevertheless, it's at least a step in the right direction. I mentioned that. We saw a long-term decline in the percentage of millennials, in this case older millennials, 25 to 34, that would check fiber content before they bought a product. But since 2011, that has at least stabilized and actually went up a little bit. So 41% say that they usually or always check the fabric content. And part of our messaging out there today is check the label before you buy. And this is the last slide I'll show you, just an index or the number of requests that we get as an organization to use that seal of cotton when they are in their either put it on a product or in their marketing or some other way. Obviously, that was declining as cotton's market share was taking a beating from 2010 to 2012. Market share is still under pressure, but we began to see a little bit of stabilization in terms of the request for seals. This past year, 2015, we saw a pretty big jump. Most of this is in the home furnishings area, but what this tells us is some of the brands and retailers now want to be able to call out the cotton in their products. They want to do a little better job of telling consumers that this is cotton. So we see that as at least a good sign, and we'll try to leverage that as we go forward to get as much cotton in the marketplace as we can. We've got a lot of unachieved goals, and I don't need to talk about those. We all know what that is. Consumer demand, number one, becoming more profitable in terms of these low-price environments and getting the value of cotton higher. But we're going to continue to work at that. We got a lot of new things going in 2016. A lot of new, some young people coming into the marketing area that have a different perspective. So we look forward to implementing programs in this next year. Again, I want to thank you for your support. Cotton Incorporated would not exist without the support of the growers. And we've had great support in this area from Georgia and from the Southeast for a long time. And we want to continue to thank you, and we'll continue to work to get the most demand as we can and hopefully grow these numbers and get that price in a better position. Thank you.
So we're excited to have Mike Quinn with us today as president and CEO of the Carolina Cotton Growers. Mike grew up on a farm in eastern North Carolina. Got his degree from East Carolina University, worked with USDA about 10 years, I think. Started with Carolina Cotton Growers in 1996, became CEO in 2001. And he serves on many, many boards and has opportunities to represent the cotton industry through the Executive Board and the National Cotton Council. He serves as a trading partner on ICE futures, just several other things here, International Cotton Associations, and he comes to us with a lot of knowledge and experience, and we're just glad to have you here with us today, Mike. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that introduction, and I'd like to thank Richie and the Cotton Commission for giving me the opportunity to be here today. It's interesting times we're living in, no doubt, and I would echo the comment he made. It is a complicated world we live in, and it seems as though since the first of the year, it's gotten even more complicated. Last night at dinner, Mike Lucas said, well, I look forward to you telling me what the cotton market's going to do tomorrow and when it's going up. Well, actually, he said, and that it is going up. Well, and I'm glad he didn't say when, actually, because I can get that out of the way right now. Cotton prices are going up. When is a different question, and he did not ask that. The answer to that question, obviously, is it depends, and so we got to talk about those things that it depends on. We're going to hit a few items. Obviously, you cannot talk about cotton without talking about supply and demand. You got to talk about the quality this year because that's playing an important part in the impact on prices. China, if you're going to talk about cotton, you got to have a China slide in your presentation. We got one of those. We'll talk about the currencies a little bit. Currency wars is the title I put on it. Seems as though various countries around the world seem to want to do different things with their currencies these days. Also, we'll kind of wrap that up into some type of market outlook that hopefully makes sense to you. So let's hit the numbers real quick. World supply and demand. This is the first time the year-over-year change in production is down 17.6 million bales. That is the first step in the right direction in correcting the cotton price conundrum we've been in for a year and a half now. Consumption is also, year-over-year, is projected to actually increase about a half billion bales based on the January world supply and demand numbers. And then you have ending stocks projected to decrease 9.2 million bales. Again, that's the first sign we're seeing that we're getting over a problem of ever-increasing ending stocks in the world, and that's a good thing. So let's kind of drill down, though, and look at what's going on in this particular year because I think it's important to see what has happened since September. When you look at the world supply and demand numbers going back from the first one that came out for this crop year in September and then going to the January numbers, you can see that the production estimate has dropped due to the growing conditions in various countries around the world. We also have seen the consumption drop slightly, but as these global economies seem to be getting in a period of flux and instability, unstable times. But nonetheless, since September, we've even seen a drop in the projected ending stocks. That's positive. It's unfortunate for those that did not produce cotton due to weather conditions, but it certainly is another step in the right direction to improving prices. Where is this occurring around the world? We have to take that into consideration. Well, when you look at the Chinese numbers beginning in September from the World Outlook Board and going through the January numbers, you can see that their production has decreased, 2.5 million bales. We can see that their offtake certainly has decreased some too, but it really leaves their ending stocks basically unchanged. So it's not occurring in China when we're talking about reducing ending stocks this coming year. You look at India. A similar situation, but they have had, again, a reduction in production estimate. There is some talk among trade that possibly the Indian crop may be reduced further in future reports, as the arrivals may not necessarily be coming in as some thought they might. That remains to be seen, and we'll see how that goes. Their offtake has pretty much remained about the same, with their ending stocks reducing slightly. Another country to kind of take in to look at is Pakistan. Pakistani crop has been cut, almost 3 million bales, and that was simply because of weather-related issues in Pakistan. And again, there's talk that possibly Pakistani arrivals may even be less than this projected here. Certainly their offtake maybe has been reduced some, again, to global concerns and uncertainty in the economic times. But through some imports, which is not on this particular chart, we're not comparing those, but ending stocks are projected to remain about the same. Then we get to the United States. We started out this year in September projecting a 13.4 million bale crop, and I can tell you that many people in the trade were, I heard numbers of 14 million potential crop in the field. Texas is going to have a barn buster. The Southeast looks good, and it did look good. Folks in our cooperative in the Carolinas and on our board are telling us we got a big crop in the field. We don't really want to talk about it, but it is. It's out there. But as we move through the crop year, we all know what happened during harvest, and we'll talk about that a little more in just a second. But nonetheless, right now, USDA has the U.S. crop pegged at 12.9 million bales. They've kept exports pretty constant, but they did reduce the export projection slightly as the crop come down, which is not unusual for USDA to do that, simply because I don't think this early in the game they really want to project an ending stock less than 3 million bales, because that cotton's got to get shipped before they can really say we're going to go below 3 million bales. When you talk to textile industry people, 3 million bales is below 3 million bales. It's not a number they really want to talk about. The domestic guys particularly, it's like we're going to be out of cotton before we get to new crop. And so that's a concern for them, and they start seeing that number going below 3 in the U.S. If we take all the rest of the countries, the rest of the world, that's what ROW is. If we take that, we take China out of all the numbers, and because that apparently where the change is happening as far as reduction of ending stocks, we see that the production is reduced from 82.7 beginning in September on this crop down to 77.8. We see that the use is fairly constant, even though it has been reduced some, but that reduction in production has obviously moved the ending stocks on this crop down in the rest of the world below the 40 million bale mark, which is causing somewhat of a little bit of a tightness in the rest of the world. And that is probably what has stabilized our markets at the level we're at now. When you view this in the context of where is the ending stocks at in the world, and you can see the first bar, the blue bar, being the world ending stocks over the past several years, and they have been increasing, but now we are finally beginning to see a projection in the drawdown, as we've talked about. And obviously China ending stocks not changed so much over the past year, but the rest of the world is where a reduction is coming at this year. A lot of reasons for that. China with their internal policy has actually caused more importation of yarn as opposed to spinning it domestically, and because of the reserve policy they have, and we'll talk a little more about that on the China slide when we get to it. When you look at the stocks-to-use ratio, which is an important number, how much is left over relative to what has been used, the world from September went from a 93 to a 92% stocks-to-use ratio. China ratio actually has gone up due to some reduced project consumption in China and not necessarily reduction of their stocks. But the rest of the world, again, dropped from 36% down to 33.5%. And again, is encouraging in that aspect that the ending stocks in the rest of the world is tight. China has kind of become an island of its own, and naturally, when they make abrupt policy changes, it can cause massive ripples throughout the rest of the world. But as long as they hold that stock and don't do anything crazy with it, then the tightness in the rest of the world would support prices, particularly in this zone we're in right now. So let's talk a little bit about quality. 2015 crop year presented some quality challenges, particularly in the Southeast. In 2014, 70.1% of the cotton class was tenderable, meaning it could be delivered on the U.S. Futures contract number two, cotton number two contract. This year, that dropped pretty dramatically, about 15%, down to 57.9% tenderable. And that is a direct result of the quality. If the quality is not there and it doesn't meet the specifications for delivery on the contract, then that's just a problem as far as high-quality cotton out there. Memphis Eastern, about 48% tenderable on the contract. And then when we start drilling down into the southeast, which where we're at, Alabama, Florida, Georgia, 49.4, indicative of the rains that occurred in the last part of harvest. Here's where it really gets interesting in our area, North Carolina, 14.3% tenderable, South Carolina, 13.2%, and Virginia, 28.6%. Can't tell you what a number that did on the quality, particularly the rains, the historic rains that occurred the first weekend in October. But it wasn't necessarily the rains that hurt things as much. It was as much or more the 2 weeks prior to that rains where we had 100% humidity. You had cloudy, overcast weather, and you had 75 to 80 degree temperatures. And this is the result of that. That's probably about the worst case of seed sprout. I know Barry's seen this picture before, and he knows the his former chairman. This come off his farm, B.B. Griffin. But I thought that picture worth a thousand words. It just shows what can happen when those conditions exist and the seed sprouts get out of hand. Just no way to make that a fine quality piece of cotton. You just hope it gets through the gin and comes out the other end in a bale somehow. When we look at the Florence classing office, and again, we had that period of time with the rains, the high humidity, and then followed by historic rainfall event, almost 30 inches in the inland part of South Carolina from Charleston in towards Columbia. Up in our area, maybe about 8 to 15 inches, depending on the spot you were at. But nonetheless, I'll have been in this business 20 years next month, and I said 20 plus because that's the time I've been in it. A lot of the growers said, no, I've been in it 40 years, and this is the worst crop we've had. But when you look at the Florence classing office data, there was a 35% yield loss from the September expectations. The average premium discount quality of the Florence office is 748 points minus. In North Carolina alone, the average discount is 800 points. So you can see the impact that it had, that type of rain event, that type of seed sprout that can occur when conditions are just not favorable at harvest. The Georgia premium discount was a minus 238 points, and that's just the loan schedule when you analyze the data coming out of the state. So you didn't escape it either. You got hit on it too. We talked at China, so we've hit the supply and demand numbers. We've talked about there is a shortage of high quality, a less amount of high quality available in the United States. So we got to have the China slide because China's China, and they hold most of the cotton in the world in reserves, so we got to talk about it. They have been the center of recent economic concern, no question about that. In fact, there was a report that came out yesterday that said the Chinese economy was down 40% in 2015 and down 24% in the month of December alone. So that may explain some of the wild gyrations that happened right after the first of the year. Their imports are projected to be the lowest level since they joined the WTO. China is limiting the issue of additional import quota. There is talk there may be some import quota that may be issued. It will be issued sparingly. You won't find out about it until after the fact. It appears they are attempting to get their mills to use the reserves. Obviously, they have a lot of cotton in inventory, and they would probably like to get that worked off the books since the value of it is a lot higher than the current market values that's out in the rest of the world. There is talk also that China may begin another round of reserve auctions. That's got the markets a little bit nervous. But they are attempting this time to offer those out at lower prices and maybe index them to the A index rather than just set a price like they did last year. The auctions they tried to do last year to their textile mills was not successful by any means at all. And that's why those mills imported more yarn than they have in recent years, simply because the internal price in China is just too high for those textile mills there. There are concerns about the quality of the stocks. They do have a rotation program, but when you have that much cotton on hand and it sits there over time, there's got to be some degradation of quality. No one really knows exactly how to put a number on that, but at some point in time, those chickens are going to come home to roost also. Another thing about China, and I was trying to put together some thoughts on what's going on economically there, because that does have such an impact. And how did we get there? And before I show this next slide, I just want to apologize for it. It goes against all of my PowerPoint training, all of my PowerPoint thoughts, to put up a slide that doesn't have a chart or bullet points, but to just put up a slide with a massive amount of words on it. But that's what this next slide is. But it's a quote, I came across this this past weekend, and I thought it was a pretty accurate description of what is going on in China and how they got there to where they're at. And it's a quote from a large hedge fund manager, Mr. Kyle Bass. Kyle is owner and managing director of Hayman Capital out of Dallas, Texas, and he specializes, I think, in identifying capital misallocations, bubbles, so to speak, and then positioning in the marketplace with his funds to take advantage of it. He did very well in the subprime crisis. And so he made a statement this past weekend on the record, and here it is. And this is the second thing I'm going to apologize for, because I'm going to read this, and I never like to do that on a PowerPoint slide either. So after we get past this one, we won't do that anymore. China many years ago attached its currency to the dollar. They hitched a wagon to our star very smartly, because back then our goal was to depreciate our dollar through inflation, so we issued debt to the rest of the world to depreciate the dollar. And so now the real problem is China has hitched their wagon to our star, and their currency has effectively appreciated about 60% versus the rest of the world since 2005, and is killing them. China's effective exchange rate moving up versus the rest of the world made their goods and services a little bit more expensive each year. And now that labor arbitrage is gone, and if that labor arbitrage is gone, the banking system has expanded 400% in 7 years without a non-performing loan cycle. My view is we're going to see a non-performing loan cycle. Now let's talk about, when you say non-performing loan cycle, what he's referring to is a subprime crisis, a Lehman Brothers event that gums up the flow of money and the credit in the country or banks. This is a worst case scenario. So let's go ahead and get the worst case scenario out of the way. And I think the Powerball question here is what will be the extent and duration of a non-performing loan cycle. Now, I said Powerball question because, you know, when I was growing up, everybody would say, well, that's the $64 million question. But since Powerball got to $1.8 billion, I think we got to rephrase that, because, you know, $64 million compared to $1.8 billion just doesn't seem very significant. Well, this is a very significant question. What will be the extent and duration? This is the Powerball question. If China is going to go through a non-performing loan cycle, will it be fast and furious? Will it last for years? Or will they be able to engineer what people would say a soft landing? And that will have a great impact on other economies around the world, and including cotton. It really will have a serious impact, so we have to think in those terms. So that's the Powerball question of the day. A little bit about currencies, because it does impact cotton trade around the world, and you can see on a weekly index, the United States dollar index since 2014 has had a pretty dramatic rise. During 15, it was gyrating back and forth within a range. And that coincides a lot with cotton, as in 2014, as the dollar index went up relative to other currencies, cotton prices came down. And now over the past year and a half, cotton prices is trading in a pretty steady range. Unfortunately, it's at a range that's not as profitable as nobody would like it to be. But nonetheless, that is what's happened, and also with our currency. When you look at China's Chinese yuan relative to the dollar, you can see that back in August of this past year, they dropped their peg to the dollar overnight and surprised the heck out of a lot of currency markets. That's the day in August that the Dow Industrial traded down 1,000 points in about 2 hours, did stabilize and come back. But nonetheless, you can see when things unexpectedly happen in currency market, it can have a dramatic impact in other markets around the world through our globalization. But since that time, they have continued to start to devalue their currency in hopes of revitalizing their export markets, because some of their labor arbitrage has gone relative to other Asian countries in that region. Indian rupee also has, your fiber competes against the Indian cotton in the exports market. As their currency goes down relative to the U.S. dollar, it makes the competition tougher. Same with the Pakistani rupee, same with the Brazilian real, and so you have competitive devaluations in many countries around the world. On the flip side, the Turkish lira, you do not compete directly. Your cotton in the export market doesn't compete with Turkish cotton. They're using all that internally, and they are a good import market or a good export market for U.S. cotton. But when their Turkish lira drops relative to the dollar, it does make your cotton a little more expensive or relative to other options that they would have to import cotton, such as Brazilian or Greece or Uzbekistan or West African. And I think we've lost a little market share there because of these currency fluctuations. So let's kind of see where we're at now with the market and try to wrap up some of this stuff and see what we think it's going to do and try to answer some of those questions Mike put forth last night. We harvested 8.15 million acres last year. It was a good to excellent conditions going into harvest, but it deteriorated throughout harvest. That was a plus. I put a plus or a minus based on whether I thought that was a positive impact to the market or a negative impact just to prices straight out. U.S. supplies of high-grade cotton are certainly in short supply. That has bolstered prices and put floors under it. What it did do also is created a very strong basis for the high-grade cotton. And a lot of that cotton prices do not necessarily, the futures market has not necessarily rallied to flush high grades out of the market and get them into the marketing channel. The basis has simply been adjusted upward, and those that had the high grades certainly benefited from that. And the combination of basis, futures, and AWP and all that working together during any given week is how the market has been able to acquire the high grades that it could so far. Specs are long cotton. You can't take them out of the equation. They are the a lot of people have made negative comments about the specs, but you need the specs in the markets to provide liquidity on those futures markets. Somebody is willing to take the risk to buy or sell and take the other side of whether one of our textile mills wants to price cotton or whether somebody else wants to sell cotton on the exchange and hedge it. Since the first of the year, they have actually been selling. Last year, cotton was one of the better performing commodities in the commodity complex, and so these hedge funds go through rebalancing. You say, cotton didn't perform well. Well, that's relative. It stayed fairly flat, but a lot of the other commodities, your base metals, gold, wheat, corn, cotton, particularly oil, they underperformed dramatically and had big negative losses. So with cotton remaining constant, they're rebalancing portfolios, taking money out of cotton and putting it into something that sold off very low. And that's what we have seen since the first of the year. We think most of that has abated now. Export sales, they're on target. Shipments are probably lagging a little bit. Overall demand seems to be pretty good, but it's not great. We've talked about the strong dollar. We've talked about the short arrivals there. And we've indicated some serious gyrations going on in China's economy. El Nino, plus or minus, who knows? Right now, reading a report this morning from Drew Lerner, who I think is one of the better climatologists out there. If you Google him, you'll find him. But his prediction is the El Nino might not be transitioning to a La Nina as fast as earlier anticipated. And his surmise of that is that during the spring planting season, it could relate to a cooler and wetter spring going in for the southern half of the United States in the next several months, as it doesn't transition as quickly as early thought it would. That will add volatility, certainly. If we get into planting concerns about cotton, that could actually, as you know, have a little bit of a weather market rally going into the spring. Exports projected at 10 million bales, sales to date 5.9. In order to reach that goal, we're going to have to sell 141,000 bales per week. That's a very, very doable number, and I would expect reports in the next few weeks with the price back down near 60 cents. I would think over the weekend, and particularly the last 2 days, with cotton breaking to recent lows again, I would expect a lot of export sales in the market were made. Shipments to date is part of the problem, 2.6 million bales shipped. We're going to have to average 252,000 bales per week in order to reach USDA goal. Not impossible. You're going to have weeks of 300, 350, and even 400,000 bales being shipped, and which would get us along the way pretty quickly. But we've yet to see that. And I think that has to do with the lateness of the crop, with the crop moving slow into marketing channels, with the lateness of the Texas crop. But we're getting that lateness behind us now, and the cotton is out there. It is changing hands, and it's moving, and I think we'll see shipments pick up. Graphically, this is what it looks like here. This is the new sales we have on the books relative to last year. But we're on pace, and the time we get, you know, over here, we should be able to reach the target of 10 million bales. Shipments here, you don't like to see it starting to, this time of year, you want to see it start to accelerate up. And that's what I'm talking about. This is just a picture of it. I think if we can't start to see in the next month shipments above average needed to reach the pace, I'm afraid USDA might have a tendency to want to lower even below 10 million bales the export if the shipments, if they don't think they're going to get there. I'm hoping that's not the case, because if on a future supply and demand report they start lowering export expectation, that's going to raise ending stocks, and that'll take some of the maybe the price appreciation that could happen out of the market. Talked about the specs a little bit, and you can here graphically see since the first of the year they did reduce their long position in cotton. This is a Thomson Reuters chart, net position of non-commercial funds. But interestingly enough, and this the last data that came out 2 weeks ago, this is a two-week delay on this data, they actually bought back some of the contracts they had sold and increased their net position. I think the specs are not in an appetite to go drastically short cotton, just because cotton has such a dramatic fall since the high, and you've reached support levels where they would be probably scared to take a big long short position and go net short in a major way. Cotton has had its sell-off, in other words. Oil is probably reaching some of its dramatic ending points on the downside, too. That would certainly help stabilize things there. When we just look at a chart outright and a few technical considerations, we're trading below our moving averages now, the 20 to 50 and the 200-day. This chart I put together Monday night before traveling down here yesterday. And what we were thinking is a sweet spot here for this down move we're having now back down to the low end of the trading range we'd be in would be in this area here. Yesterday, prices did break down below this 60-15 level here. Right now, our opinion is that they will hold above this 59-48, the low we made back some time ago. So it's probably the area that the specs are going to start looking at. I know it's an area that the trade, meaning the mills and also some of the traders in the market, are looking at probably doing some fixations in here, and that would add support to the market. And right now our thought is that we probably should hold this area, and then we can start rebounding up. We'll talk about that in just a second. Looking at a weekly chart and consideration there, we've just been in a big trading range for quite a long time, from 58 to 68 cents for a year and a half. and in recent times, recent months, in a 59 to 64. So prices are flat, supply overhead, the overhang of the large ending, large stocks that are out there, and underneath the market, and where mills and the trades see value at this 60 cent level. December 16th, right now it's just following along with the rest of the market. We've not gotten into planting yet, so we're not into a weather market yet. We will get into it, and if planting concerns become a concern, it'll start to take a life of its own. If ending stocks stay below where we're at now, then I think probably December could carry a premium. If we're below 3 million bales, particularly on ending stocks in the U.S., December could carry a premium to the July. Unfortunately, some of the grades that are out there that are able to be certificated, I don't think they'd be a big squeeze play necessarily on the contract, because everyone who maybe would take the contract may get a lot of grades that are probably not desirable, in fact, for what they would like to be able to take if they took the board. So where do we go from here? The downside, I think, appears limited due to the tightness in the rest of the world and a shortage of high grades. There are still mills out there that need to cover second and third quarter. They've not been in a hurry to really do anything, but they're getting to the point they're going to have to do some things. So I'm cautiously optimistic. That's my opinion on the market today. I'm cautiously optimistic. We are down and back to the lower side of a trading range we've been in. Any increases in demand above current expectations, I think, could push prices above the current trading range, which is the current trading range, again, is 60 to 65. So if the world economy stabilizes, if China doesn't have a hard landing, and we'll talk about that in two more slides and we'll get there. Of course, there's headwinds, strong dollar. Does China do something nobody's expecting on their cotton policy, which would certainly change things dramatically? And also, if the world economies can't stabilize, you get more of a deflation, more of a risk of recession, then that also changes the equation also. So I'll leave you with four scenarios. The highest probability of what I think will happen, starting with one, and you're going to say, oh, that was easy. Prices remain rain-bound for a considerable time still. I think that is the highest probability. It doesn't mean that's what's going to happen. In fact, and I read about every market opinion that anybody puts out there, but that is, I think, the general consensus right now of everybody who's writing anything about prices out there, is that we're probably going to stay range-bound somewhere in the 60s for a considerable time. Being the contrarian in me says, okay, everybody's now on the same opinion of what the market's going to do, so that gives me concern that maybe something else is going to happen, because most of the time when everybody gets on the same side of the boat, you know what happens to the boat. Scenario two, global economy stabilize. China avoids a hard landing, has a positive impact from the stabilizing of global economies, has a positive impact on demand, and maybe prices can surprise to the upside. I'm not talking 90 cents a pound here. I'm talking just going above the recent trading range and with the possibility of getting up near 70 cents if the global economies can stabilize and China can calm down and avoid a hard landing. Obviously, there's got to be a bad side or a bad scenario, and we're going down less likely to happen, in our opinion. Say China has a hard landing. Macroeconomics deteriorate, the recession concerns, and that negatively impacts future demand from where we are now. Then probably the price range would move into the lower 50s in that scenario. Fortunately for the U.S. farm program and the cotton farmer, you do have the marketing loan, which can offset some of that. If price goes down, your LDP goes up. Scenario four, this is just getting way out there now. That's if the hard landing exists. And then you have global central banks, the Fed, start QE5, QE6, 7. I should call this DEPCON 4. Because if you see the central banks start doing more quantitative easing after the rounds we've been through the past several years, then that's going to tell you that they think something is seriously wrong with our economy, and they're going to print some money. And if you get that, then you could get some whiff of inflation into the whole commodity complex, because the funds are going to want to seek something They can't hold cash because it's going to be being devalued, so they're going to seek something, and the commodity complex has been beat down pretty bad over the past few years. So that's a less likely scenario, but I think basically we're looking at probably staying in our trading range for the time being, and that's kind of what our thought is right now. I know I'm pushing past lunch and everybody's waiting on it. I was asked by council to hit on one thing, and Richie too. I ran it by him and the whole commodity certificate, and so I've got two short slides, if that's okay. Marking MLGs, LDPs, PLMs, and commodity certificates. Of course, this definitions, everybody knows what the marketing loan gain is, but to clarify the difference between that and an LDP, a marketing loan gain is when you actually put the cotton into loan with CCC. An LDP is when you forego the loan and collect the difference between the adjusted world price and the loan rate. And of course, payment limitations, you all know what that is. Through the efforts of the council, they were able to bring back the use of commodity certificates. And so what is a commodity certificate? It is a negotiable certificate. These are USDA definitions. And I say this because as a cooperative, we use this process, as well as the county office can use that process, as well as LSA, loan servicing agencies, can also use this process. But the mechanics of how it works is a commodity certificate is a negotiable instrument, but it has to be used for the immediate exchange of an outstanding loan collateral. The exchange rate obviously will be the adjusted world price. To be eligible to use this process, it has to have an outstanding commodity that has not matured, and it must be exchanged immediately. There was a time when a commodity certificate was actually printed on a piece of paper at the county offices. I don't know how many in here have been farming long enough for the, you remember the pick and roll scenarios that were out there. Commodity certificates actually created a secondary market of their own. They were bought and sold and traded like bars of gold at one time. Sometimes they'd carry a premium, sometimes they'd be discounted if you were approaching expiration date on, but it actually was a certificate. And in recent times, USDA, to try to eliminate that secondary market, it became an electronic record. Much like your warehouse receipt is a negotiable instrument, now you don't see it. You can't feel it, touch it, or look at it. A warehouse receipt is an electronic record in the computer. Same with a commodity certificate now. It's simply an electronic record. But in order to use it, cotton has to go in the loan. And then you can use a electronic record to redeem it from the loan and thereby capturing the market loan gain, and it would not be subject to the payment limitations. If you simply pop the cotton, those gains will be subject to the payment limitations that are out there, just as Reese indicated earlier. If you're in a marketing pool or working with a CMA, you don't have to worry about that because they're going to do that on your behalf. If you're marketing your cotton on your own, then you do need to be careful when you go to USDA and not pop it, but actually do this transaction, and that will help you avoid using up any of your limitation on the LDP or the marketing loan gain. I want to thank you for letting me come here today, and I want to make just one comment that, you know, the Southeast cotton plays a very vital role in supplying U.S. domestic textile mills and foreign mills with a reliable, great product, that is cotton. Georgia plays a vital role in the Southeast production because of your constant acreage year in and year out and the good qualities you're able to produce. You have a great organization with the Cotton Commission, and I hope the entire Southeast region continues to work together for the good of that cause, and that cause is cotton. Thank you very much.